Hello and welcome. Thank you for joining us. You're joining me, Michael Scott, from Oxford in the UK, and my joint convener, Sanford J. Ungar in Washington, DC, to this jointly promoted event between the Future of the Humanities Project and the Free Speech Project. The latter is sponsored by Georgetown University, and the former by Georgetown University's Humanities Initiative in association with the Las Casas Institute for Human Dignity at Blackfriars Hall, the University of Oxford. Together, the two projects consider issues concerning human dignity, rights, cultures, histories, traditions, in a wide spectrum of educational activity, policy, expression, and aspiration. In a moment, I'll hand over to Sandy, who is director of the Free Speech Project, to introduce today's distinguished panel and to moderate the ensuing discussion before I return to chair the Q&A session. From the start and throughout the discussion, you can type in questions to the panel by using the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. These will come to me, these questions, during the session, and I will try to put them into some kind of logical order for the panel to consider. We urge you, please, to feel free to ask questions. Any that can't be answered today, we will try to answer later by email. So that's it from me for a while. I'll see you again in a moment. So over to you, Sandy.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be working with you. This has been planned for quite some time. And if it weren't for the coronavirus, we would have been together today in Oxford and with a symposium, but we're postponing that for health, public health and scientific reasons. And in the meantime, we're going to have these online dialogues, transatlantic dialogues, until it seems to be safe for us to come together. We have a very distinguished group of people with us this morning in Washington, afternoon in Britain and evening in Europe. Ambassador Donald McHenry has had a distinguished career in American diplomacy and public affairs. He was US ambassador to the United Nations under President Jimmy Carter and was involved in long, delicate negotiations to resolve the civil war in Zimbabwe, among many other projects. Baroness Mary Goudie has been a human rights activist in the British Labour Party for many years. She now carries on that international leadership role from her position in the House of Lords. Michael Naumann is a prominent statesman and public intellectual in Germany, based in Berlin. He's been editor of the Weekly Die Zeit, a book publisher, federal culture minister in a Social Democratic Party government, and a candidate for mayor of Hamburg. Most recently, he's been active in the arts as head of the Barenboim Said Academy. Salil Tripathi is a distinguished and much decorated Indian journalist who cares deeply about the free speech rights of people who many have forgotten or neglected, including those who are incarcerated around the world. He now works from New York, where he chairs the Penn International effort on behalf of people in prison. I'm going to turn to Don McHenry first for brief remarks. I'm hoping he'll say something to us about the evolving state of free speech in the developing world. Don?
Thank you very much, Sandy. I thought I would make three points and then engage in the discussion later. The first is that as I look around the world and developments over the last 10 years or so, it does seem to me that we were on a trajectory where there was a great deal of hope as democracy, democratic systems evolved, particularly in Latin America and Africa. And I'm sad to say that I think that has seen a change for the worst in a number of places, as has there been a change in some portions of Eastern Europe, particularly in the old Federation of States of the Russian, of the USSR. But in general, you can, I think, say that this deterioration correlates with the unstable nature of democracy in a number of places. Let me say secondly that that the deterioration uses some of the same weapons that were used before, repression, but it has some new things in it, poisonings from a distance, the killing of Khashoggi, and of course, first the Great Wall produced by China, and which I think is being copied by any number of other places. The second thing is that there is an increased debate, not just in the developing world, but in the so-called developed countries as well, as to what are the parameters of free speech. We're all familiar with the slogan, you can't yell fire in a crowded theater. And it's a parameter which pretty well is accepted all around. But there are some new ones which on which there is a great debate. Hate speech, for example, is something which has entered into the discussion, particularly in Europe, to some extent in the United States, though our court has basically rejected that concept. The question of privacy has arisen. And of course, there are questions about whether free speech should be governed by religion or royalty, etc. In other words, there is now a continuation of a traditional debate on the parameters of free speech, and the old consensus, I think, is under some pressure. Finally, I think there is in this country and in Europe and surely in the developing countries, a question of what one is going to do about free speech and the new technology. Social media raises any number of questions as to the propriety of its use, how swiftly it moves, the accuracy with which rumors and statements talk. And there is some question as to whether there ought to be some kinds of controls. There's a great deal of debate on that. And I think we're just starting to see the beginning of it. Social media probably can be seen also in the debate on whether you should have talk radio or Fox News or a Sinclair newspapers chain in the United States. But they all, I think, raise the question as to how much free speech is too much.
Thank you very much, Don. Provocative questions indeed. Mary Goudie, we're so happy to have you with us today. And I wonder if you want to make it just a few moments of remarks about whether you think the principle of free speech has been eroding even in Western democratic societies. Mary?
Thank you very much. And thank you, Donald, and everyone. I'm so pleased to be with you all today. I have to say, I have thought over the last 6 years, particularly in Europe, particularly in my own country, that there is an abhorrence of free speech, that free speech is not being allowed. It's being picked on if you say something. We have the hate crime, which we've tried to make into legislation. People are being picked on. Legislation is not going through Parliament, but is being dealt to the side, which is wrong. So members of Parliament are not scrutinizing all the House of Lords properly. And also Britain is not attending, as it should, all the other human rights meetings where we would have a place at the table, because we've lost what people think about human rights and democracy. And I think it's a real worry. It's partly brought on by what's been happening in America and one or two other countries. So I'm very happy to discuss that further, but and also about girls' education, that where people are not willing to want to put more money into girls' education, not in Britain, but in other countries around the world, which worries me in particular. Because if we don't educate girls, we don't educate the world.
Thank you, Mary. Michael Naumann, is it possible to say that free speech has almost gone too far in the era of social media, as Don McHenry began to suggest, to the point where it protects and amplifies dangerous political factions and protects their falsehoods?
I don't think so. I would disagree. On the other hand, as a teacher has just been decapitated in Paris because he showed in the vein of free speech and support of free speech, he carried Muslim caricatures of the famous magazine Charlie Hebdo, and a Chechenian Muslim killed the teacher, 18-year-old young man, because he was of the firm opinion that that is too much of a free speech. So the debate emanating around the borders and the limits of free speech include, of course, cultural clashes, specifically in societies in Europe, are just learning, unlike the United States, to integrate totally different cultural masses, indeed masses, millions and millions in Germany, for instance. We have 2 million Turks who actually firmly believe in the authoritarian government of Erdogan and have authoritarian proto-fascist papers in Germany. Nobody reads them except those who read Turkish. How to handle that? That is certainly one of the issues of the paradoxes of free speech in a free society. What I'd like to come back to, however, to Ambassador McHenry's remarks about the intrinsic, almost self-societal aspects of free speech or free open communication within on the platforms of the internet. Because in the future, or actually already right now, free speech involves the exchange of data. And the real goal, so to speak, the currency of power and politics and economy, as we all know now, are data. And there are very few platforms who own these data. And whatever we utter will in the future be, if not already right now, whether it's in written form, but even in spoken form and even in different languages, will be saved and stored as data and can be used for the goods of anybody, for instance, for city planning. Barcelona has had a huge program of collecting data by people and then planning the city, and it worked. But of course, it can also work totally the other way around. And so free speech carries, if you use it specifically on the platforms of huge data gathering companies, its own limitations, and in fact, it has almost self-suicidal aspects to it, which of course leads us to an issue of where to go, how to speak, how to be open without sharing too many data on the platform, for instance, that we're using right now.
Thank you, Michael. Salil Tripathi, I think many people are remarking upon a disturbing trend toward authoritarianism in South Asia, where a very large percentage of the world's population lives, a growing percentage. Are you concerned about this?
Yes, it's a matter of concern pretty much around the world. I mean, South Asia is a good place to start. I was born in that region. And there are lots of attacks, lots of threats, many feel. Some of them are in the form of arrests under sedition charges. The threats are from the state and from the non-state actors. The state actors, of course, we know when journalists are taken away and jailed, or writers are taken away and jailed, but non-state actors, bloggers in Bangladesh is one example. You know, when they challenge religious orthodoxy, they have been beheaded exactly in the manner that, or killed or hacked with machetes. In India, Gauri Lankesh, a distinguished journalist, was shot at in front of her house and killed. So, and journalists have been arrested in Kashmir and other parts of India, in Pakistan. People who want to create a forum for dialogue at the second floor process, a project in Karachi. She was murdered by people, and many of these cases go on with impunity. But South Asia is not the only place. I'm glad Michael mentioned Turkey earlier, I think. And Turkey is a very good example. What's happening at Cumhuriyet is a very good example of what's happening to Can Dündar and Ahmet Altan and all the writers who are in jail. The list just goes longer and longer. And I think if we look at it from a structural way, the region, I mean, it's a very old story. I think what has accentuated the problem today is that the speed with which misinformation can spread and the scale at which it takes place and the spread that it acquires has changed completely. And there is a perception that the state will be a bad regulator. So therefore we thought tech companies will do the job, but now the tech companies have their own arbitrary ways of working. Do we really want Facebook or Twitter or Google to monitor and decide what is can be spoken, what cannot be spoken? Here in the US, there's a whole discussion about whether Section 230 can exist in its present form or not. What happens to freedom after speech, not just freedom to speak? And what happens to the nature of spirit of inquiry? We know what happened to Galileo at one time. So one of the disappointing things after the very tragic beheading of Samuel Paty in France a couple of days ago was what the Pope said, that when he came with what would be called it, free speech is important, but people should not be offended. And as Salman Rushdie has reminded us for years, this but brigade is a danger, that free speech is great, but, and as soon as you use the word but, you put qualifiers, and that emboldens people who are offended to start narrowing speech and discourse. I think there is a logic about dangerous speech being regulated. The speech is that poses an imminent threat of violence, of danger. The Radio Mil Collins example in Rwanda is a good one, where there's no other alternative. There's only one means of communication, which spouts and incites violence. There is a case for that. But otherwise, we must have greater latitude. How to regulate it, I don't know. David Kaye did some thinking when he was the UN Special Rapporteur for Free Expression, and he came up with an idea about how the companies can be regulated. And we need a much better multi-stakeholder approach to address this issue. But it's something we cannot let the government, this government decide, and it's something that we know that companies are incapable of deciding.
That's a discouraging notion that governments can't be trusted with this very important power. In fact, you make a good point, Salil, and we'll all get into this discussion now for a time. In many countries, including the United States now, when the news isn't favorable to those in power, it's quickly labeled fake news. And that's become a toxic term, fake news. Don McHenry, what can we do about that? And anyone else, please feel free to jump in as we discuss this.
It has become a toxic term, but the difficulty of handling something like that and of social media, I think was illustrated just this week, when the New York Post ran a story on a bogus, what appears to be bogus laptop of communications between younger Biden and his father. Twitter or Facebook, whichever it was, I can't remember, decided that this was untrue, lacked any degree of truthfulness, and they wouldn't carry that item. And what has happened is that now we have a shooting match from both the conservatives, who feel that this is censorship and should have been allowed to be carried, and liberals, by the way, on the same side, saying that this company should not be in a position where it can exercise censorship. It's a very difficult question. I think people who care about free speech are going to have to get together and come up with some kind of parameters around this.
Mary, is there a crisis in the British media over free speech of this sort, whether online or the traditional mainstream media? Do you find yourselves worrying about it there as well?
Yes, we find ourselves very much worried about online free speech. You know, it's not free speech. You know, it's put out by other people that's untrue, and it undermines a number of people, a number of issues. Sometimes the newspapers do it, but not so much. It's on Twitter, Facebook, and some of the other platforms. And it is a real worry now.
Can I just historical remark? Fake news in Germany was basically coined by Goebbels, Hitler's propagandist. It was called Lügenpresse, lie press. And that is the forerunner of Trump's fake news. So I wonder who whispered that into his ear. As to the debate about this New York Post story concerning the Biden hard drive, that is such a classical, absolutely classical trick by probably the Russians, because we've had these kind of experiences of fake, definitely fake files that were fed to the press by the East German Stasi. And after reunification, these guys who did that proudly demonstrated in a book all the tricks they did. I happened to publish it finding out that some of the stories that I had written as a journalist were based on tricks and fake news, made up news, lies fed into the West German press by the East German Stasi professionals. The stuff is going on obviously forever and ever. And we in the West, so to speak, are obviously too naive to understand that a lot of these stories, which are really smell like unprintable, but have just a whiff of truth to it, they have in fact the old ancient originators in disinformatio. As journalists of my age know exactly what it means.
What do we do about that? Who should do something about that? Salil, do you have some thoughts about, is there some kind of international regime that needs to be put into place?
It would be very hard, and it would be very hard to get people make decisions on context, right? Because Michael is absolutely right that sometimes there is not a whiff of truth, but whiff of something that seems real about it, because it's based on something that seems credible because it comes from a particular laptop and it's decontextualized, it's exaggerated. And there are two things about it. And one is that the newspapers have suffered because of their own self-inflicted blows by getting rid of copy desks and getting rid of fact checkers and internal editing systems. A good newspaper should have checked the information many, many, many times before a story of like this kind can appear. But let's assume for a moment they don't have the resources. And that's why you have the fact checkers that have come in. Now, that is an imperfect solution because they're trying very hard to get into it. But essentially what I think is required, and this is one of those big, long drawn out processes with no immediate solution, but it's the only way forward, is greater media literacy. Readers have to understand, and readers have to be empowered with tools to figure out what's right and what's wrong. And I think if we go in that direction, so that people are able to say that if something looks like a website of a newspaper, talks like it, if someone looks like a broadcaster, doesn't mean it's a credible broadcaster. Just because something looks like a newspaper on the web doesn't make it a newspaper. And I think where people need to figure, now it's very hard in the age of WhatsApp, where news travels so quickly. And you know, people have been lynched and killed in India because of rumors that spread very quickly on WhatsApp about somebody is taking a cow somewhere or whatever. So it's not easy. It's a very difficult process. But I think it's something that's the only way forward until such a time when the readers start demanding that we want credible information. And that can only come with newspapers which are better resourced.
Of course, the lack of credibility of some governments or some leaders makes it difficult to trust their regulation. And I think in the US right now, both some Republican spokesmen and some Democratic ones think that there should be some kind of regulation of social media, but neither will trust the other to do it. And I think we're, no matter what happens in our own election in a couple of weeks, we're stuck in this limbo where neither will trust the other, and perhaps some form of benign moderation, if such a thing could exist, is needed. But I don't know how it's going to happen. I don't know how it's going to come about. Don, do you have any encouraging thoughts about that in this country?
No, I don't. I think it's one which is on the front burner, but I personally don't see an immediate answer to it. And it's going to take some time to come up with a way of handling it. But we shouldn't underestimate the damage and the divisiveness which is occurring in the meantime. In the U.S. in any event, people don't communicate with one another because they can't agree on facts. And they can't agree on facts because they get their facts from different sources. Nobody believes Fox News, and Fox News listeners don't believe the other side or any other outlet. And what do you do about this situation? I don't know, but it is very divisive in terms of the political stability of the country.
Mary, the British media have always been polarized, haven't they? I mean, we've always known their conservative papers, their labor papers, or at one time might have been called socialist papers. Are there any better solutions being thought of there?
I think that the Financial Times has moved towards the center much more. Besides being a financial paper, it's also a paper about issues and global issues. The Guardian is printing much more global and issues that we wouldn't normally have seen on the streets before. That's because the Scott Trust wants that to happen, while the Times and the Telegraph are what they've always been, to the extreme right. Even if the information isn't necessarily correct, it's what they print, and then you've got the tabloids, which are something else, but the papers in Britain are split at the moment, as with the media platforms, which I think are really worrying. The media platforms are our real worry. And also some of the journalists who work for some of the newspapers then run platforms to put out information.
Michael, please.
The interesting thing is that we, right here, us here on this platform, we all, I think, belong to those folks who believed in the sanity and the rationality of a society that educates itself, that informs itself with newspapers, less with radio, but with newspapers. And the truth, the unfortunate truth, is the New York Times, in a nation of 320 million, has a circulation in paper of approximately 800 to 100 to 1.2 million on a Sunday. It used to have up to 1,000 pages. People won't believe me, but it's true, on Sundays. The leading papers in Germany are just barely scratching by. So in other words, the newspapers, as like in the 18th century onward, as the foundational informative platforms for all the democratic societies, are gone, more or less, or have very little importance. Which brings me back to my original argument: who then has the power? Well, the platforms, Facebook, TikTok, of all, can you imagine a teenage website to amuse children and teenagers, owned by a Chinese company, is going to be influential in defining the upcoming American election? You have to wrap your head around that to understand the ramifications of all of that. So here we sit and discuss the endangerment, so to speak, the dangers to the freedom of opinion, when in fact that freedom has diversified into ownerships by huge corporations. They own the freedom. They do decide what to do. And Ambassador McHenry, as you said, you don't know the answer of what to do about it. Well, you still have the Taft law to break up these enormous companies and reduce their power by splitting them up.
Salil, the Indian press in particular has always been very lively, or maybe not always, but in recent years. In my visits to India, I've been stunned by how openly many things are discussed. As long as it's not Kashmir, there seems to be a great deal of free press activity in India. Is that under the current Hindu-oriented government, is that being cut back to any extent?
Well, there's a lot of freedom in Indian media today to criticize the opposition, right? In the sense that a lot of the newspapers, but certainly the broadcast media, because like in other countries, broadcast is becoming increasingly the main source of information. There's a big dispute about whether the ratings are accurate or not, but the most widely watched, assuming that those are widely watched channels and networks, they are incredibly pro-government. When they interview the prime minister, they ask questions, and I'm not making this up. Sir, do you like to chew the mango or cut the mango, or do you like to suck it because it's more juicy? These are the kind of questions that were asked to the prime minister before the elections by an actor who was brought in to conduct an interview on television. So you have that on one hand. And anytime any opposition leader speaks out against the government, the response is vituperative, and which is fine. I mean, I'm not saying that you have to regulate that conduct or content because one's politics may be on one side or the other, but that's what has happened on the television side. On the print side, there is a lot of reluctance to write certain things which are critical of the government unless you have almost legal level of evidence to back it up. I mean, even if it's a mild criticism of the judiciary, and there are many reasons why Indians can be upset about the way the judiciary has been functioning, but it becomes very hard to say it. I mean, there are people who are saying it. There are websites which are doing it. So you're absolutely right that old spirit survived, but there is a counter offensive which often comes online, and it comes from stormtroopers or you know, the foot soldiers of the right, which attacks those people with ferocity, which is quite harsh. And it's particularly bad for women journalists and writers. I mean, there is a journalist who writes for the Washington Post called Rana Ayub, another broadcast journalist, a woman called Barkha Dutt. The kind of hatred and abuse they receive is astonishing. And they are brave enough to continue, but it can silence a lot of people. And Amnesty International had a very good report looking at globally the problem. And it's not just restricted to India. They looked at Britain, they looked at the US. In many countries where you have this kind of an attack on women journalists and writers. But A, they are being silenced through attacks of this kind. And B, in some cases like Anna Politkovskaya, Daphne Caruana Galizia, or Gauri Lankesh, they're actually murdered.
This year, there's been a special problem because of the coronavirus and the pandemic. And recently, much has been written that in some countries, especially in the developing world, the pandemic and public health scare has been used as an excuse to silence the media or get the media to be more accepting of what the government is doing. I wonder if any of you would like to speculate about what the condition of speech will be when, or I should perhaps say if, the pandemic is brought under control. Will there have been some permanent damage as a result? Mary?
I'd just like to say a few words. I think that newspapers are on the way out in terms of as a paper copy. I think we all accept that. So it's whether people are going to take them on their tablet or on their phone. And that's going to be the real problem for newspapers. Because as we've seen with the pandemic, there's not many printed newspapers around. And I think we have to look to that as we come out of this.
Michael, what has the pandemic had a silencing effect to some degree in Europe on journalists trying to do their job?
I can only speak for Germany and in the very beginning, let's say in March, April, when it became clear to the government that this is a very, very serious long-term threat. The German press really supported the government. And there was hardly any opposition to the recipes offered by the government. That's one of the reasons why, in fact, in the very beginning, until the summer, Germany suffered by far fewer deaths than our neighbors, and certainly fewer deaths than the United States. So percentage-wise. However, by now, because we have a federal system and every state has different ideas of how to handle the crisis, the opposition to the government per se in the press is getting louder and louder. And then, of course, there is something else which is makes it even more complicated. We do have, just like the United States, a very populist movement which picks up proto-fascist attitudes towards the press, weirdly enough, as if the press caused the pandemic. And so it's journalists have the same experience in Germany as, let's say, CNN reporters who try to mingle with QAnon demonstrators. When you go to one of those right-wing demonstrations in this country, which are strangely enough supported by the Russians, I mean, this is complicated, but true. And they make no qualms about that. Journalists, liberal journalists, normal journalists actually have difficulties actually posing questions. They might actually get beaten up. So this has already happened. The government, however, is more or less still on safe grounds and doesn't have to worry about it too strong and hard opposition. The press is more or less in support of the government, although with rising oppositional tones, so to speak.
Don, in this country, Donald Trump didn't lose much time in beginning to call the media the enemy of the people. Right. And at some of his rallies, some of these rallies that he loves to do, he's actually encouraged people to attack journalists physically on some occasions.
Well, Sandy, when I was an undergraduate in college, I had a German graduate student as a roommate who did one of the best things that I've ever seen on the use of speeches and rallies and the big lie and so forth. And I tell you, every day, Mr. Trump sounds more and more like the 1930s.
Yes. You can watch his on YouTube.
That's right.
And you can hear the phrase Volksfeinde to the press, that is enemy of the people. So yes. Actually, good old Trump's not so original.
Well, original or not, it's had a major impact in this country. I think there's a little bit of naivete in this country about some of the extremes to which this can go.
Well, there was a warning, though. I mean, Philip Roth wrote that wonderful novel, The Plot Against America, you know? So
yes.
It should not be so hard to go back to that, yeah.
No, that's right. But I mean, these... some of these right-wing, extreme right-wing, white supremacist hate groups that Trump seems to, the general term is, sends a dog whistle to them, only they can hear it in some ways, that he's on their side, he's ready for them, or he will be ready for them to mobilize. This strikes me as, I'm sorry, stand by.
Yes.
Well, those are loaded words, stand by.
But then we ignore this at our peril.
But what can we do about it, Don?
Well, I hope in 10 days or something like that, we'll take the first step.
Right. It's extraordinary that such a thing would happen in a Western democratic society, even now, that... a person in power with a significant amount of power, even though one house of Congress is not under his control. It's an extraordinary thing that someone in this position in a society that prides itself on its constitution and its balance of powers and so on.
But don't forget, our constitution and our whole history has been that people will work together, they will work within certain parameters. This guy has a different view. He knows he'll get pulled back by the court, but in the meantime, he'll do whatever he can. He knows that ultimately he may be slapped down, but in the meantime, he will do whatever he can. He skates very close to the edge, and he really doesn't care.
But can I, Sandy, you sounded almost melancholic or... It's not, you know, as long as a nation like the United States is able to create one comedy series after the other on Donald Trump, things are not as dangerous as you think. I mean, I enjoy Randy Rainbow, and I watch Bill Maher, and I watch these comedy shows, which by now are much more than comedy shows. They are actually classical cabarets of the Weimar Republic. Criticizing and actually hurting potential dictators where they hurt most, and that is they usually have not the slightest sense of humor. So laughing about Trump is actually one of the best remedies available for the press, for the media. And there's lots of laughter about this man too.
Well, I think that's a good point. Of course, so much depends on what happens in these next few weeks. I think a lot of us are sitting on the edge of our seat. Salil, do you have any advice for us?
It would be too presumptuous for me to advise anybody, you know, I mean, anywhere. So I wouldn't want to dare go there. But I agree with Michael about the ability to laugh at the emperor is a good sign. But other countries where, you know, people have tried to use cartoons and humor have not been very effective. And, you know, they've had to, I mean, in some cases, as we know with Charlie Hebdo, of course, they've been murdered. Even in India and places like that, stand-up comedians have been forced to recant and apologize and all that. And, you know, just in case the election results are not what this panel seems to want in 2 weeks from now, I don't know the level of freedoms that would exist for some of the stand-up comedians. And I'll say this, I'm a huge believer in the First Amendment and great believer in the US system, but 5 years ago, I had no idea that understanding the US would be like trying to understand Indonesia or Malaysia. You know, I mean, I could bring my Southeast Asian and South Asian experience, and I could say that, yeah, US is pretty similar because the president's nephew does this and the son-in-law does that, and, you know, everything looks like a developing country democratic infrastructure. And therefore, I go back to, you know, what was never said by Jefferson, but something that is attributed to, you know, eternal vigilance being the price of liberty. And I think we will have to keep remaining. And it matters, you know, how the US takes a particular view, because its view still carries a lot of weight in global human rights mechanisms. If the US steps away from the Human Rights Council or the International Court, it has huge repercussions. It emboldens other people. It would embolden Viktor Orban. It would embolden President Duterte. It would embolden Narendra Modi to act in certain ways. So I think it's very, very important that these structures are not affected.
I think that's a very eloquent way of putting it. We're going to, in just a moment, head back to my colleague, Michael Scott in Oxford, to share with us some of the questions that have been raised by our participants around the world in this conversation. Our conversation is coming from Washington, Oxford, London, Berlin, New York, still a pretty rarefied atmosphere. There are some people around the world who are struggling for free speech, whom we know about, we have visited, we have been personally exposed to it in many cases, but I think we don't know just how severely that can impinge on their daily lives. Michael, perhaps you'd like to take over with the questions now.
Okay, thank you very much. What an interesting debate we're having here. And questions are coming in. You're stimulating the debate. Just a note for myself to start off with. Of course, in 2016 we had a terrible experience in the UK when an MP, a female MP, was named Jo Cox, was assassinated. I mean, she was killed. And one of the aspects of this was the hate mail that was coming in to many, many female members of parliament in the UK, and it continues to do so. I just wonder whether any of you've got any comments about that what is happening from hate groups who are targeting in particular women in public office.
Caroline Triada-Croes is another example. You know, she campaigned for the £10 note to have Jane Austen image on that, and she was also targeted. You're absolutely right. And I think that's what I alluded to earlier, the Amnesty report, which looked at the attacks on human rights defenders, journalists, writers, and political actors, such as the MP. It is a problem, and it does require much greater effort on the part of the social media companies to monitor the traffic. And essentially, I know this sounds like a very motherhood and apple pie type statement, but essentially create a society which, you know, does not pick on what are perceived to be vulnerable groups and initiate hate. And it's not easy. It requires a far greater collective effort than, a regulatory fiat.
Yes, I think Mary Goudie's not been very well. I think she's left us. Is that the case, Sandy?
I believe that's the case. Yes.
Yes. Well, hopefully she'll come to a future debate that we'll have. Can I go on to ask? As Rosemary Galley has asked, how does the panel view the persecution of Julian Assange? Is this not a strategy to silence free speech around the US and other countries' foreign policy?
I don't know how up to date people might be with the Julian Assange case. Michael, are you familiar with it? Michael Naumann?
Yeah, I mean, the man is obviously has been framed. The notion that two Swedish professional prostitutes claim to have been raped by him, that's the only reason he has been arrested, or rather in self-imposed exile in an embassy in London. Otherwise, he would have had to go to Sweden, and Sweden has an extradition deal with the United States. He would have ended up in the United States for having published on WikiLeaks these materials that showed you how, with much abandon, people were being killed by American soldiers shooting from helicopters. So in short, it's still an ongoing scandal.
He, of course, has been indicted under the Espionage Act now.
Yes,
and
right.
Many people fear that if he can be prosecuted and convicted in the United States, he'll be in exactly the position of newspaper reporters and publishers who receive secret information, and they will in turn be threatened as well. Sorry to interrupt there, Michael. That's just a...
No, it's absolutely true. I'm looking at old Vietnam movies on YouTube. Every one of those famous journalists, including David Halberstam, would have been under the same, with the current climate in the United States, would have been under the same danger of being arrested for espionage.
Right. Sorry, Mike Scott, that's a particular parochial concern of people in the media in the United States right now.
Oh, that's great. And it's thanks, Rosemary, for asking us that question. Another kind of interesting question, similar, I think, comes from Jeff Rosenberg. And he says, Germany has long had a law prohibiting speech denying the existence of the Holocaust. Is this a commonly accepted regulation? Have people been prosecuted for violating it? And do you see any possibilities for this type of regulation to have a wider acceptance, or is there too great a potential for abuse?
Well, first of all, yes, people have been prosecuted, and it has been fairly effective. And secondly, Facebook, I think, has finally agreed to make this one of its self-regulating rules. Denial of Holocaust is going to be squashed on Facebook.
Thank you.
And how do you feel about that, Michael? Is that?
I do feel positive about that. There are things of such a traumatic consequence, historically speaking, for a whole nation, that to lie about what had happened, what had been perpetrated by the Germans, by us, and then to lie about it means basically denying the responsibility. What arises out of the Holocaust that is of unbelievable mass murder from the nation of perpetrators, or rather our forefathers, is a responsibility to prevent this in the future. And one way to prevent this is to prohibit any denial. So that's why this makes legal sense, and I'm happy with it. And those people who deny it actually are classical neo-Nazis, and there is a limit for me in this country, maybe with a different history than others, a limit of tolerance, and that is exactly the limit. So?
Okay, did you want to say something, Don?
Well, I tried to point this out in my opening remarks, that there is something of a difference between the United States and elsewhere. We've not done the hate speech thing. We've not done the Holocaust, that is, legally. There is, however, a great deal of political pressure to damp down both the denials and the things like hate speech. But I think our courts would say that's part of free speech.
Well, this leads on to Piers has just asked a question here. How do the panel assess the claim that the speech of powerful people ipso facto diminishes the freedom to speak of the powerless, and therefore should be curbed on some occasions? The argument is often heard in the context of university no platform policies and speaker disintegrations. Who's going to take this one?
I'll try. I mean, it's a good and powerful argument that, you know, and it came to the fore with the whole Harper's letter that came out earlier, just before the start of the summer in America. And this is about that cancel culture argument, right? That many writers who have platforms, who are well known, signed a letter saying that this cancel culture is wrong, that, you know, this no platforming is a bad idea. And it's a persuasive argument. I do think that people with power do have access, but I do not necessarily think that those who are without power, that the way to address that problem is by taking away the platform from those who have the power. I think the platforms need to be widened. I think that's the solution. That's a good free speech oriented approach. So if people feel that a prominent writer has all the say and he can say or she can say what she wants, and others are being denied, then the problem lies with the gatekeepers who are not letting those speeches to come in and not letting that speech to flourish. And I think we need more conversations, more access, and freer and fewer barriers to entry than to say that those with power should speak less, because that is dangerous. Because, I mean, I keep going back to 1989, and, you know, was Salman Rushdie an author with a lot of power then? Some would say yes, because he had written Midnight Children, which won the Booker Prize in 1981. And yet he was being, you know, people wanted to deny platform to him in an extremely brutal manner. Should that be, and of course, what he said may have been offensive to some people. And those people who were saying that they were offended could argue that we are without power and he has a power. So does that mean that an author such as him speak less or watch his words or her words. I don't think that's a solution. I think the solution does lie in, if you don't like a book, write a better book, write a counter argument and challenge that viewpoint rather than, and while recognizing that power is a major player in the argument.
Thank you for that. Any other comments on that? Okay, shall I go on to another question, which actually seems to tie up with this as well. Minos Trastakis says, what is the root reason that new platforms in America stick so firmly to their potential bias, e.g. CNN and leftism, Fox and conservatism? Does it have anything to do with company profits and their target audience? It is hard to accept, Minos says, that every single reporter of these channels is genuine expressing the views that appear.
What a good question.
Yeah, who's going to take this one?
Well, let me defend CNN. I'm watching CNN regularly. I don't see any commercial forcing these journalists who actually are, most of them are actually commentators. CNN has become a commentator paradise. Obviously of liberal or leftist attitude, but then listening to the screaming voices from hell on Fox News, I think I'd rather take tendentious leftist liberals in comparison to screaming ladies who actually literally scream. You might even hear them across the Atlantic. So, but the truth is both of them are not what you'd call traditional journalism. They're entertainment just as well. Trump is the sad victory of an entertainment culture that he himself created. And so he's surrounded by entertaining TV stations that barely come up to the original boring, but wonderfully solid attitude of a Walter Cronkite. So that's part of the history.
Michael, if I may add one quick point here, there's a widespread belief that if Donald Trump should lose the presidency, and if he leaves office in an orderly manner, that he plans to start a new network of his own, which would compete with Fox. It would be further to the right than Fox. I think attempts to improve civil discourse would be immediately sabotaged by, in this case, the former president.
Do you think they'll arrange for a radio station in Sing Sing?
Anything is possible.
Yeah, let me get to another question. This comes from Richard Dalton in Wolverhampton. Is there any justification for politicians to be economical with the truth? As for example, in the present C-19 virus pandemic. Can they be economical with the truth, or should they give the whole truth?
Depends from case to case. During the Cuba crisis, which has been researched really into the last little corner, every single fact had been clear to the public. We might, in fact, had a nuclear war. So
you would argue that in a crisis, Michael, sometimes information needs to be suppressed.
Yes. To avoid hysteria, wrong reactions. You had so many people on both sides, the Russian and the American side, who actually did have a finger on the trigger. All the submarine captains were able, without any order from Washington, to fire nuclear torpedoes, or in fact, even missiles. And so not to keep them abreast of every little single corner and single discussion pertaining to this issue of those missiles on Cuba between the decision makers in Washington and the Russians. Remember Dobrynin, the ambassador. Every little decision, every discussion between these people was secret, and rightly so, because both sides tried to solve, without public pressure, the crisis as peaceful as possible. And they did.
I think there is no comparison between that situation and what Mr. Trump has done with regard to this pandemic.
Oh yeah, I agree. I totally agree. I said, it depends from case to case.
No, he apparently told the Washington Post writer that he kept information about how toxic this virus was because he did not want to panic people. On the other hand, if it is clear to me that if he had leveled from the beginning and taken a more comprehensive approach to this situation, we'd be much better off than we are now.
Yes, definitely. I agree.
Thank you. There's a question here from Sophia Baum. What role do you think the next US president should have regarding the detrimental effects of widespread misinformation online? Should there be a task force created to monitor social media?
And who controls the controllers? Mm.
Who selects the members of the task force?
Absolutely.
I think you're going to have a continuation of the reviews that we're having in the legislature now, as they try and look at the pros and cons of this. I think there will probably be some consideration of breaking up companies, though that doesn't always work. But I'm not at a task force yet.
Okay, I think there's what, yes, I think Payal Mangla, thanks for yours, but I think that's been answered through the last question as well, your point. As we're coming towards the end now, I'd just like to make a comment of my own, really, because as some of you might know, I'm a professor of Shakespeare, and that's my area of interest. And what's so interesting is that these are questions, similar questions about the social media coming up now, that were coming up at the time that Shakespeare lived. And indeed, not just the social media in terms of the written word and the printed word now being available for the populace as a whole, but also through the theatre. And there were regulations, and I just remind people of the regulations that are part of history. 1581, all plays had to be submitted to the master of the revels in case there was political or religious sedition. That was taken up further in 1607, when it was extended to the printing of plays. In 1737, there came a new licensing act that reinforced it. In 1843, there was a Theatres Act which reinforced it. And in fact, censorship of the theatre didn't cease until 1968 in the UK. So It's been, we've got a long tradition that we're talking about people creating an atmosphere when they can't speak. But another issue that came up also in the early 17th century was that of equivocation, where people would defend themselves by saying one thing whilst thinking another, you know? And they would say that they were actually committed to the truth, because although they had said something which was a lie, actually they were thinking something different. So,
that
anyway.
Seems in baseball sometimes.
Yeah.
Not a strike.
Yes. Well, we're trying to stop it in football with a VAR, but it's not working very well. Yeah. Yeah. I think, gentlemen, and I'm sorry that Mary Goudie has left us now, but I think we've got to now draw it to a close. So may I thank Mary Goudie, Donald McHenry, Michael Naumann, Salil Tripathi, and my colleague Sandy Ungar for what has been a stimulating discussion and for answering the questions from a very wide audience. I understand that we've had more than 300 people viewing this today. So thank you very much, all of you, for your engagement. Can I thank my colleagues at Georgetown University, President Jack DeJoya, Vice President Tom Bancroft, and the Dean of Georgetown College, Chris Chalenza. Thanks also to Yvonne Quack, our US Administrator, and Carrie Johnson and Jamie Moore Kael from the Free Speech Project. And they were feeding the questions to me. Shaman Tong also made the Zoom possible, and we thank him very much. At Blackfriars Hall, I thank John O'Connor, OP, the Regent, Richard Finn, OP, the Director of the Las Casas Institute, and Kingarona Gabnai, our UK Administrator. Can I thank everyone who has asked a question today? If they weren't all asked, we will try to answer them by email. And if they weren't asked, it was because of time constraints and nothing else. And can I thank you all for attending. The next Free Speech Project through Zoom, in association with the Future of the Humanities Project, is planned for the 1st of December at 4 p.m. BST, 11 a.m. EST. And I hope Mary Goudie is better and will be able to join us perhaps for that. And I know she sends her apologies. She told us before she came on air that she was feeling poorly. Information will be sent to you if you've been engaged in this production. It'll be sent to you in due course. The next Zoom event in the Future of the Humanities Christian Literary Imagination series, sponsored by Georgetown University's Humanities Initiative in association with the Las Casas Institute, Blackfriars Hall, Oxford, will be on the 27th of October, 4 p.m. BST, 11 a.m. EST, and that will feature Dr. Peter Davidson from Campion Hall, Oxford, who will be speaking about the literary works of Robert Southall, SJ, poet and martyr. And I hope you will join us for those events, and you'll be very welcome. May I thank again my co-convener, Sandy. We've been working on this for quite some months and become great friends. And we hope that this is going to go on to some other programs in the future. I'm Dr. Michael Scott. I'm Fellow and Senior Dean at Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. You can follow me on Twitter at MikeScottProf. Until the next time, take care, keep safe in these dark days, and goodbye. Thank you.